But you'll find Colossians, like, back at the almost to the very back of your book if you brought your Bible. And we are looking at Colossians 3, verses 8 through 14. And it goes like this. It wasn't long ago that you were doing all that stuff and not knowing any better. But you know better now. So make sure it's all gone for good. Bad temper, irritability, profanity, dirty talk. Don't lie to one another. You're done with that old life. It's like a filthy set of ill-fitting clothes that you've stripped off and put in the fire. Now you are dressed in a new wardrobe. Every item of your new way of life is custom made by the Creator with His label on it. All the old fashions are now obsolete. Words like Jewish and non-Jewish, religious and irreligious, insider and outsider, uncivilized and uncouth, slave and free, mean nothing. From now on, everyone is defined by Christ. Everyone is included in Christ. Paul goes on to say, so chosen by God for this new life of love, dress in the wardrobe God picked out for you. And what is it? It's compassion, kindness, humility, quiet strength, discipline. He goes on to say, be even-tempered, content with second place, quick to forgive an offense. Forgive as quickly and completely as the Master forgave you. And regardless of what else you put on, wear love. It's your basic, all-purpose garment. Never be without it. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
are such fun, though, are they not? Are they awesome? Come on now. That is awesome. Well, I'm going to give you a little background on Patsy Cline to begin with, right? And then we'll get into it. So Patsy Cline, her voice is one of the most influential voices in country music. And still to this day, she died in 1963, and today she is still the most played. That song is the most played song on jukeboxes all across America. Now, who wants to tell us all what a jukebox is? Yeah? Yeah. All right, so as I was driving here, I'm thinking, how do I explain what a jukebox is? It's like having Spotify in a box, right? A big box, and then you just pick the songs that you want it to play, right? It's the same thing as on your phone. You just pick your playlist, right, and you put it in there. Although this was just a big box that played records, and you had to pay for it, right? Anyway, so one of the things about Patsy Cline was she was not only a country singer, but she had crossover hits. Not a whole lot because her career was really, really short, but the impact that she made was amazing. So she said, I can't read a note of music and I've never took a singing lesson in my life. Can you believe that? That's crazy. Oh, wait. Did you get that? That's crazy. That's crazy. One of the things that I read about her that I really loved was this. It says, her Nashville sound, as with her wardrobe, was iconic as her swearing with abandon and her calling everyone she knew Hoss. I am going to start calling everybody I know Hoss. I just love that. What's up, Hoss? How you guys doing back there? Haas, you got it? Okay, there we go. She was born Virginia, or Ginny Hensley, and she had dreams of making it big. She came from a small town on the wrong side of the tracks, and everybody in town told her, Ginny, you're not going to make it. It is too hard to get in that business, especially if you come from nothing. And she kept at it. She wanted to make it one day to the Grand Ole Opry. But people kept giving her negative feedback, telling her, you are never going to make it. She barely had an eighth grade education. She came from a single parent home. She worked to help make her family's ends meet. And still, she figured out how to work it out into the music business. One of her friends said, it seems like every time she would get up, like she'd have a hit like I Fall to Pieces, then things would wane and she'd get knocked back down again. She'd get knocked back down again. And then she met a producer who believed in her talent, who said, I see that in you. I see that in you. We're going to do something together. And that's kind of what Paul is saying to the church. He's saying, I know you have that in you. I see that in you. I see it in myself, he says, but we don't always live up to it, do we? Life is hard. There are stumbling blocks. There are things that come into our life that we do not want to deal with, right? And we fall short. We just do. And so, like Patsy, we get knocked back down. But Paul was talking to the church, and he was talking to him because what we heard, what he had been hearing, was that people were talking. There was a gossip mill going around, and they were saying that Jesus was not actually God. And he had to intervene in that. He was in prison, and he had to intervene in that. So he sends them this letter, right? And he talks about how we are the people of God. And he knows how hard it is because he uses the words, you're going to have to pick it up and put it on. Because it ain't easy, right? You are going to have to find that humility. You're going to have to find that gentleness. You're going to have to find that spirit. And even if you have to dig to the bottom of the hamper, pull it out, grab you a dryer sheet, and throw it in the dryer for a hot tumble. I'm revealing too much right now, aren't I? I'm just saying. I know you guys do it too. Don't even start with me. Don't even start. He says, you're going to have to find it. You're going to have to dig deep, and you are going to have to put it on and wear it. And sometimes it's going to be uncomfortable, but do it anyway, right? So in the scripture, we hear compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. But Paul goes on to say that we should bear with each other and forgive one another. And forgiveness is one of the hardest things, right? It is the hardest thing. And in the song, we hear her crying out about, I'm crazy for loving you. Everybody else thinks I'm crazy for loving you, but I love you anyway, right? And isn't that who we're called to be, right? It's those people who are unlovable, those people who don't deserve our love, those people who have hurt us, have brought us down. Those are the people that we are called to forgive. And you better believe you are going to have to pick that up, shake it off, and put it on. Right? You're going to have to. Because the world tells us we are crazy when we love as Jesus calls us to do. But here's the deal. The truth is, all of us, all of y'all, and me, we can be pretty unbearable ourselves at times. Am I right? Yeah. And we expect the same from others because it's been done for us, right? It doesn't always happen that way. And so those are the people that you might need to forgive. It's a lovely idea until we have to actually do it, right? Truth of the matter is that this song, Crazy, was written by Willie Nelson. And you've probably heard him sing it before. It was written by him when he was struggling as a songwriter and as an artist. And the song itself, I found out, was really about his love relationship with music and how he couldn't get into music. I'm crazy for loving you. All the time I'm rejected. You don't love me. You don't want me. I'm crazy for still loving you and being part of that. Isn't that a cool twist to that? I didn't really realize that. And, you know, I wonder if Willie got the idea for his headband from Patsy. Let's see that picture again. We got that? There she is. I wonder if we got that headband idea from her. Story behind that, I think, I don't know this for sure, but I think that right before recording Crazy, she was in a near-fatal car accident. And she about lost her life, and she had a huge gash across her forehead. And she came and recorded Crazy on crutches in one take. One take. So I don't know for sure, but I'm wondering if that's why she's wearing the headband here. But it's a lovely accessory, isn't it? She was way before Olivia Newton-John. What am I saying? Okay. So what she wore, that headband, what she wore and her outfits were iconic too. So as we're talking about Paul calling us to put on love, put on kindness, humility. She had amazing costumes that her mother made. She made the dresses for her, but they were a little out of the ordinary for her time, right? I think we might have some pictures of some of the things that she wore. Okay, first of all, she was out of the ordinary because she wore bright red lipstick. She was a groundbreaker. She did not take any... She didn't take anything off of any hoss that came around. I'm just saying. And in that time, she was a groundbreaker. Okay, what else we got? Oh, there she is in her iconic Like she was like the first one that brought the fringe into being cool. Her mother made that dress. Look at her there. She's at the Grand Ole Opry, first woman ever to wear pants at the Grand Ole Opry. Look at her go. You do not mess with her, right? So she was, in fact, a groundbreaker. She didn't shy away from hard work. She would completely reject the idea of choosing between a family and a career. She'd be on tour, and then she would come home and take care of her family. She was a parent full-time, too. So she did not believe that female singers needed to be submissive or demure. She was proudly outspoken and bold. She was the first female country singer to headline in Vegas. She was unique and driven. And so are we. We are unique and forgiven. So I want you to remember that God does not treat us the way that we tend to treat others. We have been forgiven, set free, reconciled to God, and how can we do any less for anybody else? We are called to forgiveness. Yes, it is uncomfortable. We are called to love. Yes, it is uncomfortable. But that's who God has called us to be. Now, I don't know if you guys are familiar with the Christian artist Matthew West, but he asks fans to write their stories to him, and maybe he'll write a song about it. Right? Maybe he will. Well, it turns out that somebody sent their song in, and he wrote a song about it called Forgiveness. And he says this: Forgiveness is about Renee, who lost her daughter Megan in a car accident at the hands of a drunk driver, a 24-year-old named Eric, who was by all accounts a great guy, but he made a tragic mistake. Renee has been on a journey of hatred and bitterness, and until she realized that the only way she'd be set free was to forgive the young man who took her daughter's life. In a miraculous way, after her daughter's death in 2001, Renee began giving presentations about drunk driving. And in time, God put it on her heart to forgive this man and reach out to him in prison. She learned that until she was set free of the anger and bitterness she held towards Eric, she was going to be the prisoner. She was going to be the one behind bars. As a result of that, Eric himself found his own faith in Jesus Christ. And they developed a unique friendship to the point where she and her family consider him a son. Hear some of these words from that song. It's the hardest thing to give away, and the last thing on your mind today is forgiveness. It always goes to those who don't deserve. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they cause is just too real. It takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness. And then there's a cry almost in the middle of at the end of the song that says, "Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Forgiveness. Help me now to do the impossible." When we forgive, it seems crazy to everybody else, right? Even hearing that story, we think to ourselves, I could never do that, right? I'm not sure I could do that. But Renee did. That's not how her story ends. But here's how Patsy Cline's story ends. On March 3rd, 1963, just 2 years after recording Crazy, she flew into Kansas City with her manager and two other artists to perform at a fundraiser. After they were done, they took a plane back And just outside of Camden, Tennessee, their plane crashed. There were no survivors. She was 30 years old. Her career spanned a short 5 years with just a few hits, but her staying power was nearly 7 decades. Later, her impact on the music and the history and gender equality are unmeasured. She had her own style, which rubbed people the wrong way. It wasn't easy, but neither is forgiveness. Jesus stood in the gap for us, and we are called to stand in the gap for somebody else. Right? Jesus did that. So we can consider him a trendsetter, right? Yeah? So my question for you is, what's in your closet? Won't you pray with me? Loving God, we want to wear love in our relationship with the world. We want you to work in our hearts. Give us a spirit of forgiveness so that we can move toward others clothed in your thoughts, your feelings, your purposes of your heart. God, show us where we fall short so that we can confess it and release it. Help us, God, to give everything that stands in the way of being loved to those you love so much. Use us as an agent of your family, together in perfect harmony with the world. We pray this in the name of the one who taught us to pray these words. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And everybody said, amen. So as we come to our time of offering, I'm going to invite who's ever at the end of the row to grab the basket and pass it forward. And then if we have a couple people who will pick up the baskets, that would be great. And today I wonder if you know how important your offering is so that in the work that we do, in the ministries that we do, that we let people know what we know. Through our humility, through our kindness, our gentleness, our forgiveness, and that might draw them near. So we thank you now for your generosity, for the ways that you support this church and the work in the world. And we thank you for being who you have been called to be. God, we ask for a blessing over these gifts, that you might multiply them for your work in the world. We know that there are people out there, God, who are just crying out to you, who need your love, who need to know that they are worthy and that they are of value. God, won't you draw them near to this community so that we might embrace them. In your name we pray. So there was a there's a wonderful song called "Make You Feel My Love." You might know it from Garth. You might know it from Adele. But it was written by Bob Dylan. It was number one country song on the charts in 1998. And within the song it says, "I'd go crazy, I'd go black and blue. I'd go crawling down the avenue. There ain't nothing that I wouldn't do to make you feel my love." And isn't that who Jesus is? There ain't nothing that he wouldn't do to make us feel his love. So as we come to the table, we're reminded of what happened when Jesus came to the table at that Last Supper. We're reminded of these words. It says, "The one who will betray me is here at the table with me." And all the guys, I'm sure, are looking around thinking, "It ain't me. Nope, not me." And then when Judas gets up to leave, there's a huge sigh of relief in the room. You know, just, "Oh, good, it's not me. It's not me." But what Jesus also knew when he sat down to eat with each of them was that Peter would deny him and the disciples would desert him before the night was over, right? So when we receive communion, we have to recall that part of the meal, the betrayal, the denial, the desertion that would follow. As we consider repentance, forgiveness, and restoration, we must remember that Jesus knew who he was sitting at the table with, and he shared a meal with them. It brings new meaning to who is this man who eats with sinners, prostitutes, and tax collectors. You could add betrayers, deniers, and deserters. And he ate with them anyway. And that is crazy. He reframes our world, right? He allows us to see things from God's perspective. And when we do, we know there's a bigger story, a crazier story that defines each of us. A story of forgiveness and redemption, where the broken are healed and the lost are found and grace is poured out. So whatever is separating you from who God has called you to be today, your wait is over. It is finished. Won't you pray with me? God, we ask a blessing over these elements, that they might be for your work in the world, that as we receive them, they might sink into our bodies and change us from the inside out. God, we know who you have called us to be. Continue to be the change in us. And everybody said, amen. And I invite those who are coming to help to come up at this time. Everybody is welcome at God's table. You'll be given a piece of bread, and you can dip it in the juice. You can say, thank you, hallelujah, amen, praise be to God, or you don't have to say anything at all. And if you would like, Andrew's going to be in the center with some prepackaged communion elements. If you would rather go that way. And as you come, the rest of the story for you from the story of Renee and Matthew West and Eric.
Here's where the story comes full circle. We went on tour this fall with the Into the Light tour. We played Forgiveness every night, and Renee was a special guest at many of the shows. She shared her story with the audience in person. We did 4 shows in Florida, the state where Eric is currently in prison. And I was blown away when the Department of Corrections agreed to allow Eric to attend all 4 of those concerts.
Tell you what, if you ever wondered what forgiveness looks like, what redemption looks like, what a miracle looks like, what healing looks like, what victory looks like, what freedom looks like, I can think of no better picture than what you see on this video.
Renee and 11 of her family members each took turns standing before a judge and speaking on Eric's behalf. They asked the judge to cut his sentence in half so that he could start a second chance at life. The judge had never made this decision before, but after hearing Renee and everyone speak on his behalf, he agreed to cut Eric's sentence in half. And before the end of 2012, Eric will be a free man in more ways than one. I hope this song, Forgiveness, and the powerful story that inspired it has challenged you, maybe even forced you to ask yourself some questions. Do I really get it? Have I let it wash over me that God sent his only son to die on a cross for me so that I don't have to wear the weight of all my sin and all my shame? See, we all have that opportunity to experience the freedom that Eric has, to experience the joy and the victory and the healing that Renee has. We can be prisoners set free, and all we have to do is say, yes, God, I need you. I need your forgiveness in my life, and I accept it right here and right now. I pray that you won't let another second go by in your life without discovering the freedom that's found in the power of one word. Forgiveness.
And that, my friends, is
crazy.
Now get out of here, Hoss.